Hello, how are we doing tonight? All right, so for those of you who don't know me, I'm David Fitzpatrick. I'm the scientific director and CEO of the Max Planck Florida Institute for Neuroscience. And I am delighted to see all of you here tonight for our second Science Meets Music 2017 presentation. We have a very special program for you this evening, with a lecture from a scientist whose work is revolutionizing, and okay, no hyperbole here, revolutionizing the biological sciences. And we have an exceptionally talented musician of international fame who is revolutionizing our understanding of what is possible to achieve with a harp. So, to all of our longtime friends and supporters here tonight, welcome back. And to those of you joining us for the first time to experience this unique event, combining the best of science and music, we're delighted to meet you and hope we'll continue to see you for all of the rest of the events of this season. As always, we'd like to thank the Benjamin School and Bob Goldberg, head of school, for their continued partnership in this series and for providing this outstanding venue. And we'd like to give a very special thank you to our good friends, Jimmy and Becky Mayer, who continue with their outstanding support of the Science Meets Music program. Jimmy and Becky, thank you. Now, as you know, this is the part of the game where I tell you a little bit about what's happening in the Institute. And I'm very proud of the fact that we just had our biennial neuroscience research conference. It's called the Sunposium. Okay, little laugh there. No, seriously, it is called Sunposium. I encourage you to Google it. There's only one of them, and it's here. We did it at the Palm Beach County Convention Center. Amazing. Inspiring, at least in part thanks to the speaker who is with us tonight who gave a plenary lecture there. We do a record crowd, about 400 people attending from across the globe. Our speaker panel included two Nobel laureates, making a total of 9 Nobel laureates that we have brought to Florida for our Sunposium. Yes. And we're very proud of this. We have an eye to the generation of scientists. And we sponsored over 20 undergraduate neuroscience students to attend from 4 Florida universities. They are part of our Max Planck Florida Scientific Fellowship Program that is made possible by a generous appropriation from the state of Florida. We had an exceptional scientific poster session Monday evening, where we had over 120 scientists and students presenting their research, which came from 35 institutions, 13 states, and 7 different countries, coming to Palm Beach County, okay? This is really what we have hoped for, what we've been working for, recognition from the international scientific community that exciting things are happening here in Palm Beach County, at Max Planck, Florida, and at the Jupiter Life Science Initiative. Okay, I have to tell you about one other thing that is happening that's related to the Institute. We made an announcement of this on Monday, and you may have seen this in the news. There'll be an exciting new addition to our Jupiter Life Science campus. Now, some of you may have heard of super resolution microscopy. It's a form of microscopy that is really changing the face of biological research, making it possible to use light to achieve an understanding of biological structure with unprecedented resolution. Now, Max Planck director Dr. Stefan Hell's Nobel Prize-winning super-resolution imaging technology will soon be made available for the first time in the United States at Max Planck Florida's Jupiter facility. So, a Barrier Instruments America, Max Planck Society's spin-off company, and manufacturer Stefan Hell's STED imaging technology has chosen NPFI's facility as its U.S. headquarters. Now, the addition of a Barrier Instruments America to our life science campus here in Palm Beach County will elevate the reputation of the county and the state as a source of research tools that are driving the next generation of scientific advances. A Barrier STED technology will come into our facility at the end of March, and we're all very excited to welcome them as the newest addition to the Jupiter Life Science Campus. Now, a little bit of exciting news about tonight's lecture, because it's the first in the history of our Science Meets Music lecture series that the musician has reached out to the scientist to learn a bit about what the scientist is doing and plan his program around that. So you will be hearing an extraordinary musical program inspired by and complementing Dr. Charpentier's groundbreaking research. And I like this because I think it exemplifies the true dedication and passion that all of our featured scientists and musicians possess. And we all can't wait to see or hear what's in store for us tonight. So another first is that for this evening's event, we are collaborating for the first time with the Chamber Music Society of Palm Beach. Now, to introduce this evening's musical performance, I welcome Michael Finn, Executive and Artistic Director. Michael comes to us from New York, where he worked at Lincoln Center as the Director of Performance Activities and Associate Dean at the Juilliard School. A performer himself and a graduate of the Juilliard School, he's appeared in nearly every major concert hall around the world. Maybe not in Australia. just teasing. But seriously, Michael, we're so happy to be partnering with you tonight, and please come up here now.
Thank you, David. We're honored to have been asked to collaborate with the Max Planck Institute and to appear on such a distinguished series of lectures. We also want to thank Becky and Jimmy Mayer for underwriting the musical portion of the evening. Thank you again. The Chamber Music Society is a relatively young organization. This is our fourth year, and we're midway through the season. So we hope that you'll be able to come hear some of our concerts, either in Palm Beach at the Singular Mar-a-Lago Club, or in West Palm Beach at the Rosarian Academy. Almost a year to the day, actually it's tomorrow, we had the privilege to present Emmanuelle Charpentier on our series, and Palm Beach hasn't been the same since. We record all of our concerts, and this is a good time to check your phones, because we're recording tonight, and his concert has been broadcast 8 times nationwide to an estimated audience of around 2 million people each time. So it's a remarkable concert you're about to hear, and it was a remarkable concert then. And if you would care to go to our website, it's archived. You can listen to it as many times as you like. Please welcome a remarkable artist, Emmanuelle Charpentier.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I'm happy to be here with you tonight. Excuse me for the accent, obviously, but we are two French here tonight, so that I won't be. I was very thrilled when I was asked to perform in this series, first of all, because I grew up loving sciences. I actually had my baccalaureate, it's like a high school graduation, in science with a specialty of math. And I was I almost started medical school when I was 16, but music got me first. And so I left the town I was born to go to Paris and study at the Paris Conservatoire. And then I stayed in the music field. But I am really always very interested in science, and this is something that catch my eyes all the time. So, and then when I learned who I was gonna perform with, and when I was even more thrilled because we shared the same first name, Emmanuelle, which is already good. But then, I mean, when I saw what she had done in the field of genetics, I was blown away. It's the technique that she invented with her team is really a revolution. It's true, and we like revolutions in France, you know that. So the idea then was to reach out to her and to know what she... I'm going to play a little moment now to introduce her lecture. And so I wanted to know what kind of music she was listening to. And she's very busy, and so she got back to me and she gave me one answer. She gave me the name of one composer who was Eric Satie. Eric Satie is a French composer for the late 19th, early 20th century. And I have to admit, I was not really surprised to hear this. First of all, because he's one of the French favorites. And secondly, because the music he composed is like, puts you in a trance. It's very hypnotic. And I think with the hectic kind of life Emmanuelle Charpentier must have every day, it must be nice for her to sit down and have some quiet music. So I'm going to start with two works, the most famous works by Eric Satie, La Gnosienne number one, and of course, Gymnopédie number one. Thank you. And then, just as a little joke before she enters on stage, I choose a very short piece by Marc-Antoine Charpentier, who bears the same name than Emmanuelle Charpentier. He wrote a very famous Te Deum, and this is the prelude.
Wonderful, Emmanuel, wonderful, truly wonderful. Now it's time to hear from another Emmanuel. Dr. Emmanuelle Charpentier is recognized as a world-leading expert in regulatory mechanisms, underlying processes of infection and immunity in bacterial pathogens. Her work has led to a number of seminal discoveries and insights into pathways governing antibiotic resistance and virulence of bacterial pathogens. And it's laid the foundation for the development of a novel, highly versatile, and specific genome editing technology. I bet most of you in this room know this name, which is amazing to me, CRISPR-Cas9, a discovery that's transforming life science research and could open up whole new opportunities in biomedical gene therapies. The resulting field of research that she started is now developing at dazzling speed, with exciting new aspects emerging almost weekly. Now, as you've already heard, Emmanuelle grew up in France, a small town near Paris. I was delighted to see that earlier in her life she pursued piano and ballet, but her leaning towards medicine eventually flowered into studies of the life sciences. She stayed in Paris for her undergraduate work and received her PhD at the nearby Pasteur Institute. She came to the U.S. for her postdoctoral work at Rockefeller and then at NYU before she returned to Europe, taking a position at the University of Vienna. This is where she focused on, I love this, deciphering how all the biochemical pathways in the bacteria are regulated. And this is what we like to see in the Max Planck Society, right? We want to see someone who's really taking on the fundamental challenges of biology. And this is where she began her interest in a stretch of DNA called CRISPR, which serves as a part of the defense system, the bacteria's defense system against viruses. I mean, you can kind of think of it as the bacteria's immune system. And this is a beautiful example of the tremendous power of basic science and the importance of pursuing curiosity-driven basic science. For out of the fundamental questions that she was asking about how bacteria cope with viruses, has come a technology that's making it possible to edit genes in plants, animals, and potentially in humans. Now, after spending some time in Sweden, Emmanuelle arrived in Germany, first at the Helmholtz Center for Infection Research, and more recently as a director at the Max Planck Institute for Infection Biology in Berlin. Now, you know, we always talk about how many awards people have received, and it's impossible to tell you all the awards. My God, Emmanuelle has received an enormous number of awards. Here's just a couple of them. Breakthrough Prize in Life Sciences, the Princess of Asturias Awards, this is basically the Spanish Nobel Prize, the Gruber Foundation International Prize in Genetics, Leibniz Prize. Time Magazine designated Emmanuelle one of the 100 most influential people in the world. And there are few who doubt that she will be receiving a phone call with an invitation to Stockholm in the not too distant future. Now, beyond her scientific accomplishments, Emmanuelle is co-founder of CRISPR Therapeutics and ERS Genomics, created to facilitate the development of the CRISPR-Cas9 genome engineering technology for biotechnological and biomedical purposes. Now, from what I've just said, I think you have some understanding of how incredibly busy Emmanuelle's life is right now. And I want to take this opportunity to thank her so much for taking the time to come to Florida to be with us at Symposium and tonight at Science Meets Music. Her presence is another sign of how far the life sciences have come in Jupiter, Florida. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Emmanuelle Charpentier.
Thank you very much for the very kind introduction. It's a great pleasure for me to be here and a great honor to participate to this event. Surely I would like to thank the Max Planck Institute here in Florida, the Max Planck Florida Foundation, the Benjamin School, and the Chamber Music Society of Palm Beach. So thank you very much, David Fitzpatrick, for the very nice invitation. I think you have really established a wonderful institute in this area that is really at the forefront of research in the field of neurobiology. I think as well, I know that some of you are really also supporting this Max Planck Institute, and I'm quite impressed by how this area of Florida has really grown, and with really the help of some of you to really found education, culture, and science, and I think it is very important in our days when, everywhere around the world, specifically maybe also here in the U.S., there are always some threat to have some cuts of state and federal funds to really promote education, culture, and science that is so important to support in our days. Now, I like very much the choice of Emmanuelle for Marc-Antoine Charpentier. As far as I know, he's not my ancestor, but who knows, maybe he is. I don't know. having said this is Baroque music that was played in the Cour du Roi, with in front of kings and queens. But French people, they like revolutions, as you say. And, you know, some time ago, we decided that there would not be kings and queens any longer. But I'm very, very pleased to have the chance to have Emmanuelle Cesson to really play harp. The reason of my choice for Satie was because I played piano, and Satie, Eric Satie, is a composer for piano, I'm quite obsessed, actually, by a little bit minimalism in my life. I always try to be minimalist, but it's not always easy. I'm glad to have had the chance to study a mechanism in bacteria that is very simple. Actually, it's close to minimalism, even though it's very versatile and sophisticated at the same time. But I like Eric Satie as well because it's melancholic, yet there is a sense of happiness in his music. And I guess I'm... During the day, I always go from being very happy and having this very melancholic side, which is an important part for me to live as well, in principle. So I will explain you a little bit what is CRISPR-Cas9 about and make some connections with music. So CRISPR-Cas9 is referred as really a game changer in gene editing and genome engineering. And this is the first page of an article that was published in the magazine Science already 3.5 years ago, in the summer 2013. And you see on the picture of the first page of this article, something looking like more like a planet with maybe some, how do you say, shuttles, whatever. And actually, this is not a planet. This is a bacterial cell infected with viruses. So these are these green particles called bacteriophages, so the viruses of bacteria. And they can sit on the bacterial cell that is has different shapes, like instruments can have different shapes. And in principle, they can inject their genetic material into the bacterial cell, and then there will be replication of the genetic material of the virus, and the viruses can be produced to kill the cell and propagate to infect other cells and kill other cells. And so this is really what is represented here on this picture. And you see a title, The CRISPR Craze. This really defines this new field of research referring to the development of a genome engineering technology, CRISPR-Cas9. CRISPR Craze because, indeed, the field of research has grown very fast. And this is really referring to a system existing in bacteria, allowing bacteria to defend themselves against viruses. And the understanding of the mechanisms behind this immune system have led to the development of this revolutionary genome editing technique that allows precise gene surgery, so really surgery on genes very precisely, in virtually any cell and organism that the biologist can study, surely considering the bioethical aspects of cells and organisms that can really be studied in the laboratory. So the way it works is as follows, and actually when I was looking at the harp, it's like, in a way, a triangle. You have three corners, and this CRISPR-Cas9 technology maybe doesn't look like on this picture because it's represented as scissors to explain you how it works, but it's three components. So in principle, I was just thinking it's like the harp. You have three components for the system to work. So the system works like programmable scissors, and the system acts on DNA. So all organisms are made of cells. In cells, you have the DNA that is really the molecular support for the genetic material. So the DNA, these are this kind of ribbons here represented in gray that could look like a little bit, we say in French, partition. I think in English, it's music score, actually. It looks a little bit. And so the idea is that, so this is the DNA that is composed of somehow a code with four letters. And this programmable system works like scissors to recognize specifically a portion of this DNA, the genome, and to cut very precisely at a specific place on the genome. And this cut can trigger, depending on how the biologist after designed the technology, but can trigger changes in the genome, like replacing one gene by another gene, or even acting to really change specifically the letter code of the DNA. So this is in a way like a musician would like to correct the notes of the music score and will just edit the music score to really change the outcome of the music. And sometimes if you change a specific note, you can have a drastic change in the output of the music. So this is a little bit how this tool works. Now this is an important technology because biologists rely on a lot of techniques to understand how cells and organisms work and all the pathways involved in terms of mechanisms involving a large number of molecules and allowing really to understand the basic fundamental mechanisms of life. And this is the genetic aspect is really important. Also at the fundamental level, for example, in the field of medicine, because this is a field I'm interested in, to really understand diseases. So a lot of us are focusing on cancer diseases, heart diseases, genetic diseases. Here in Florida, with the Institute and others, a focus on brain diseases. And there is always a need to understand really how the cells work, how mechanisms can lead to diseases. So we look at these aspects at the cellular and molecular level. So we need some technologies, including really the idea to really act on the genetic material and the possibility to exchange a gene by another one or delete a gene and see what will be the outcome. So this allows us to really identify genes, their functions, the pathways in which they are evolved, and also the molecules they code for. And this is very helpful to not only for the basic science and the purpose of the knowledge, but also to find mechanisms that one could harness for new therapies to treat diseases or new technologies. This is a case of CRISPR-Cas9 that is really a technology to act on the genome. And this is always for the aspect of preventive or curing purposes or to develop new kinds of medicine or new kinds of surgery. And CRISPR-Cas9 is really a new type of gene medicine, gene surgery. So this is really like a medicine acting on genes. Having said this, my interest is more with regard to infectious diseases, particularly diseases caused by bacteria. We ask actually the same questions, and this is really by my interest in understanding mechanisms allowing to understand how bacteria can cause diseases in humans that we came to CRISPR-Cas9. Now, if I bring CRISPR-Cas9 in the history of genetics, so as you may have famous musicians, you have also famous scientists, so they do not release maybe new musics, but they make discovery and they perform in the lab some experiments and leading to very interesting findings. And with regard to fundamental genetics, so the understanding of genetics really started in the 19th century with the establishment of rules, like with Darwin on the origin of species, Mendel on the laws of segregation of alleles, and in 1871, Friedrich Mescher, who isolated DNA. So this was really an important aspect in the genetic field. This was followed in the 20th century, within 1944, the discovery that DNA was really the carrier of genetic information. Then in 1953, the determination of the structure of the DNA that is composed of a double helix. And in 1966, the genetic code was revealed. So these four-letter codes that allow to understand how genes can produce proteins. And surely this was a great excitement. But the need for biologists to understand the genetic code and to be able to work on genes and DNA in the cells. And in the mid-70s, you have interesting discoveries that were done in bacteria and also in viruses with the identification of proteins with enzymatic function, proteins that can really target DNA and that can allow to really recombine the DNA and do what we call molecular biology. And this was followed by the possibility to sequence the DNA, meaning to really read the DNA code, to amplify the DNA, and surely the development of different techniques, but techniques that were a little bit lacking in terms of their simplicity, their versatility, and their power. And this is what CRISPR-Cas9 brings. It's a programmable system, and it works very efficiently and in a versatile manner, and it really changes the life of biologists working on plants, on human cells, on different types of model organisms. And so this has made a highlight of a number of journals, not only scientific journals, but also journals for the public. So I am sure that you have most likely, or maybe most likely, read an article mentioning this CRISPR-Cas9 technology. Now, this technology, as I said, is very useful to really perform better genetics and simpler genetics and more efficient genetics in plants. And it's important for the production of crops for the agriculture field. Also the ability to edit and engineer the genomes in human cells, which was very difficult prior to CRISPR-Cas9. Also in mice that are one of the model organisms used to understand diseases or understand the functions of our cells and tissues. Zebrafishes are other types of animals that are used in the lab, or flies that are also used in the lab to understand the basic mechanisms of life. It's also useful to perform genetics in fungi and also in bacterial cells, archaeal cells. So it's really transforming the world of life sciences in general, which, as I said, agriculture or the production of crops, synthetic biology that is important for the production of fuels or for all the biotechnologies that are important for also to improve the life in our society, and human medicine on different aspects. I'm not going to enter into this, but in an indirect and direct way, there is already an application in human medicine, specifically with trying to really accelerate the finding new mechanisms and new targets for developing new types of medicine. Now I would like really to switch to the origin of the system. Initially, the system is an immune system existing in bacteria, as I said, allowing bacteria to defend themselves against their viruses. So the origin of the system is really a mechanism that will target the DNA of the virus and block the propagation of the virus. And this has been harnessed to target any DNA of interest. And I just want to mention a few words on bacteria, because this is an important field in my research. We are interested in bacteria causing diseases in humans and trying to find new anti-infective strategies to be able to fight infectious disease, specifically for those bacterial clinical isolates that are resistant to antibiotics available in the market. So on the left side, this is what you think you look like, but actually you look like on the right side. We have actually 10 times more bacterial cells than our own cells in our body. So you have certainly the bad bacteria, and we can be colonized by bacteria causing diseases without actually developing the disease, or at some point maybe we will develop the disease or not. But we have also our friends, so the very good bacteria that are very important for the good immunity, the bacteria colonizing the gut. So the bacteria are really part of the world. They are everywhere, and we are very glad to work on bacteria because they have incredible, fascinating mechanism that can be harnessed as technology. So we really rely a lot on bacteria. Now here it's a slide that is a little bit with a relation to music, in a way. So on the left side, you have the picture of a scientist from the Netherlands, Anthony van Leeuwenhoek, who actually is mentioned as having discovered bacteria. And on the right side, you see the first bacteria, the first image of bacteria that were recorded. And those bacteria were observed on plaque scraping from his teeth, which he looked through a microscope. So you see different shape of bacteria. Now this microscope is very very primitive, but I find that this microscope looks a little bit like a violin. But after I discussed with Emmanuelle, because I showed him his slide, and he told me that it looks like the paddle of his harp. So, but I found this interesting, and I had this slide before this event because I already presented this slide in the past. So I'm bringing you this slide now because it's science meets music, or the other way around. Now, this technology originates from a bacterium called Streptococcus pyogenes, also known as group A Streptococcus. You see here the red, the bacteria colored in red for the purpose of the picture, invading epithelial cells, so pharyngeal epithelial cells, colored in green for the purpose of the picture. And this bacterium is responsible for a large range of diseases, mild infections, pharyngitis. A lot of kids have this pharyngitis caused by group A Streptococcus, and more severe invasive infections. I'm sorry for the picture, but this is what we deal with. A bacterium that can cause a flesh-eating disease, so this is the end of a patient having necrosis due to Streptococcus pyogenes, and in general, even with an antibiotic treatment, the patient will not survive. Now, having said this, this is also, and I also had this slide before, actually. And I like this slide because it's related also to my time in Vienna. This project actually started in Vienna, and as you may know, Mozart has lived for a long time in Vienna and has died in Vienna. And it was good for me to start in Vienna working with Streptococcus pyogenes, a famous pathogen for famous musicians. So there are some different theories. So it's pretty clear that Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart really died from a strep pyogenes infection. I mean, at the time, and he died at 35 years old, but at the time, anyway, there were a lot of bacterial infections around, and he had a number, obviously, of strep pyogenes infections during his life. Also smallpox, obviously, he had a lot of infections, but it is really said that he died from Streptococcus pyogenes infection, most likely the rheumatic and inflammatory fever caused by strep pyogenes, although there are some latest theories published in 2014 mentioning that maybe he died from a kidney infection caused by strep pyogenes. Now there is another composer who has a link with Streptococcus pyogenes. This is Gustav Mahler. Obviously, he was very much affected by the death of one of his two daughters, and with Maria Mahler, who died in 1907 from scarlet fever and syphilis, scarlet fever caused by Streptococcus pyogenes. Having said this, it seems as well that Gustav Mahler died from a strep pyogenes infection. So the immunity is really with regard to bacteria can attack the human host. We have an immune system to fight bacteria and also viral infections. Bacteria can also be attacked by viruses, as I showed you. So these are these kind of phage particles. And here I would like to mention that bacteria are very interesting organisms. Surely it's not an organism with a brain, but these are unicellular organisms, but actually they are not unicellular organisms. They really live together as a community, and they work in concert. This is actually the word we will use if we describe, even as a scientist, I use this kind of terminology. that molecules work in concert to really somehow allow to regulate gene expression in bacteria, and bacteria work in concert in this kind of so-called biofilm structure. So they communicate a lot with one another by producing molecules, sensing molecules, and it's a little bit like a music of molecules secreted by bacteria and sensed, so they listen to one another. They have a very heavy social life. They have also a sexual life. They exchange genetic material. And with this regard, they can be infected by foreign genetic material, like foreign viruses. So they have also different structures involved in this exchange of genetic material. And this is the defense system, with CRISPR-Cas being one defense system allowing the bacteria to really fight the viruses. This is how the system looks like, but I'm not going to explain you the different steps. I go back to the scissors. This is just a slide to acknowledge the different institutions where specifically I did the work. So I started my career in France, then I followed in the US at different places in New York, including the Rockefeller University and New York Medical Center, but also in Memphis, Tennessee, at St. Jude Children's Research Hospital. And then I really started my career as an independent investigator in Austria. Then I moved to Sweden and now in Germany. So we are like musicians. We also often have to move from countries to countries to perform our work and also present our work. And I would like to finish with this slide. This is actually my lab, how it was 2 years ago now. My lab has grown, but this is also to mention that we are a little bit, at least at the beginning of our career, we are performers, we are also composers. We work a lot alone, but we work like in an orchestra, and surely this is the outcome of an orchestra that brings this very nice science and very nice findings. And yes, and I would like to finish with this, to say that the most important in science is really the young community of enthusiast scientists, and it is critical to really support education, science, and culture in this context. And I would like to thank you for your attention.
Four letters, A, T, C, G. For you, they probably don't mean much, but for any genetician, they are the base. They come for adenine, cytosine, thymine, and guanine, and they are the base for our DNA. With those four letters, when you put them in a different order, you are going to express a different protein and a different code. Basically, those four bases are life, the symbol for life. And so they are very important to geneticians. For us, musicians, we have four other letters that are very important. B, A, C, H. Obviously, you understand why. Because I don't know if Bach actually died from streptococcus, but I know that without Bach, we wouldn't have any Mahler, nor Mozart, nor Debussy, Satie, or any major composer. He is our base, and we need him when we learn music, when we grow up, and we always get back to it. So I found it in order to present a suite by Jean-Sébastien Bach. This is the French suite. It's not random, of course, because Emmanuelle and I share the same citizenship. And so this is in five movements.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. And just to finish this program, it was funny for me to find this link, but with the technique that Emmanuelle Charpentier and her team developed, which is called CRISPR-Cas9, it's basically the idea of being able to cut a gene and sequence and put it back together in a different order, or add something in, or like basically, like she said, edit some music, edit a music score. And actually, it's kind of stitching something to make out life, a new life, or a more beautiful life, or to correct mistakes, or things like this. So it's a little bit like stitching joy, I found it. So there is a word for this in Greek, and that translates in English. It's called the rhapsody. It comes from Greek etymologically, and so raptein means stitch, and ode, like a song or an ode, is like so stitching a song. And it means, actually, a rhapsody is an outburst of joy or something like this. So I'm going to finish this program by a rhapsody, and not the Rhapsody in Blue by Gershwin that all of you know, but without a clarinet, it's going to be kind of difficult. So I'm going to play a rhapsody by a French composer. France is here again. Sorry, guys. He was called Marcel Grandjean, and he's French, but he's also very American at heart. He was one of the major harpists of the 20th century, and he migrated to the United States in the 60s to become one of the most prominent professors at the Juilliard School in New York. He actually is kind of the grandfather of the father of most of the American harpists today. And this is his major work. So, Rhapsody by Marcel Grandjean. Thank you. Thank you.
promised you two revolutionary people tonight, and I think you saw that. That was absolutely fantastic. Thank you all for coming. Just a reminder, our next Science Meets Music will be March 24th. We'll have an exciting lecture on an entirely different topic. Have you ever wondered why birds flock? Have you ever wondered why fish school? Well, we will have a Max Planck director who has been studying this, and I will tell you, you will learn an enormous amount about things that you never imagined learning. So I look forward to seeing you there. Please have a safe trip home, and again, thank you for your support.